Hey everybody, let me remind you one more time about my new blueprint for success. It's a project I've spent months and months working on just to help you jumpstart your comedy career and beat the competition. Whether you want to do stand-up, sketch, improv, acting, writing, producing, directing, radio, social media influencing, or even if you want a career behind the scenes as a manager or agent, Blueprint for Success will give you all the tools you need to take your career to the highest levels. With exclusive interviews, my top 50 commercial-free episodes from industry standard, one-on-one coaching with me, and unprecedented access into my knowledge and experience from over 40 years in this crazy business, I guarantee you that with Blueprint for Success, you'll become the creator you've always dreamed of becoming. No one's asking me to do this. I want to do it because I want to help you become truly undeniable. So just go to barrykatz.com, click on Blueprint for Success, and start your incredible journey today. I truly can't wait to work with you to help you change the trajectory of your comedy career forever.
Yeah, a lot of people I can rattle off definitely thought that it was just luck and that they could be there too if they just managed to find their way in. And I've known a lot of people like that who they put all their time into their marketing. They put all their effort into their ingratiation, and it doesn't matter. If you can't do the job, it doesn't matter whose ear you get into. And not that many people can do that job.
Hey everybody, welcome back to Industry Standard with me, Barry Katz. What a pleasure. Very happy to have you here. I am in New York City. I'm enjoying myself. It's been an amazing trip filming Brad Williams' special and hanging out at the comedy clubs, the Stand, New York Comedy Club down in the East Side, which I never had seen before, and also the Comedy Cellar and the Comedy Underground and the Fat Black Pussycat, if that's what you call it. I can't remember. Just an amazing time hanging with all the comedians, and it's just a great energy here in this city. So wonderful. And I got a chance to sit down with some great people to interview as well. And one of those people is Dave Sirus, who is a really inspirational, incredible, incredible artist. I can't wait for you to hear the podcast with him. Before I get started, I want to let you know that if you need to reach me, you can do so at Barry Katz at Instagram or X or at barrykatz.com. All right. Without further ado, let's introduce Dave Sirus. I promise you this will not be one of those long-winded introductions because he will not tolerate that. He's a big fan of word economy and getting it all out in the most efficient way possible, unlike my career. So let's go for it. Dave Sirus is a writer and comedian who has worked on Saturday Night Live, Triumph the Insult Comic Dog, wrote the movie King of Staten Island, and co-created the show Bupkis, both with Pete Davidson and Judd Apatow. He started out as a stand-up comedian in high school and became successful on YouTube with the original character he created, Brickstone, in 1997. Throughout his comedy career, he's worked with some of the best people in the world, including the ones I mentioned earlier, and also people like Ron Bennington, Jon Stewart, and George Carlin. One of the most respected writers that I've met in the business, working with some of the greatest people I've met in the business. Ladies and gentlemen, what an honor. Please welcome my guest today, live from New York, Dave Sirus.
Hello.
Are these chairs comfortable? They feel like I'm back in some kind of time machine here.
The chairs are a worthy adversary.
I'm glad you said that right at the top, because what I wanted to talk to you about is something that very few people talk about: word alliteration.
I'll call it word alliteration. Maybe you call it something else, where you put words together that come across as uniquely original phrases that work tremendously well on stage and gain you immediate respect by your peers in stand-up. Worthy adversary. Phenomenal phrase that would be tremendous in any comedy routine. I always say this to people who will listen and some who don't. When I first saw Nick DiPaolo perform, I'm paraphrasing, but I'll never forget the three word alliterations he used. He says, "I'm having a bad day. I went into a sub shop. There's nobody there. Then a guy comes out. He's wearing one glove, and then he has a plunger in his other hand without a glove. And he looks at me and he says, 'Can I help you?' I said, 'Yes, you can start by boiling your hands.'" So the first word alliteration, boiling your hands. Then the next line was, the guy says, "What do you want me to do?" He said, "I want you to wash your hands like you're sterilizing surgical tools." Sterilizing surgical tools. Incredible word. And then the last line was, "I don't want the rhinovirus in my tuna." And so there's three phrases that, to me, add so much to the story and the joke and whatever. And I find you to be a guy who knows how to find the phrases that go into a joke or routine that maybe other people aren't thinking about.
I mean, you hope so. I mean, it's, yeah, a lot of it's just sort of trying to find, like, what's the bluntest way of saying something. It reminds me, though, of I remember once talking to someone who had written their first script, and it was a period piece, and I remember saying that, like, the trick with writing something that takes place, like, in a time period is, if you use the terminology that they did use in that time, it comes off really corny because everyone's heard it so much. So, like, it, you have to do this weird thing if you want to have a good script that feels like it is real for that time period, which is, you have to invent slang that didn't exist but sounds like it existed. Because, like, there's this weird thing that, like, when Westerns do that a lot. Because if you had a Western where you actually used the way people talked, they would all sound like Yosemite Sam. And they would always say, like, tarnation. They would just say all these things that you're so used to that it's corny. And so you have to kind of cheat it. You have to say, you have to invent phrases that sounded like they existed then but didn't. It's a funny kind of thing.
Give us an example and the audience of something you wrote or you invented something and cheated it that didn't exist.
Oh, God. See, I actually haven't in my writing had to do anything that was in a time period. But, well, no, like, there's a period thing that a pilot I worked on where you are kind of, like, I don't know, like, the exact language, but, like, you're trying to take the things you heard as a kid but then change them in a way that no one has said them, you know, like, what, you know, like, if you can't, like, everyone would have said, like, you know, what's your damage, you know, but then you want to say something more specific to, like, what exactly happened to your brain, like, it's a very dumb thing, but, like, it's just, you want to just say it in a way that, like, it wasn't something that people picked up on and made a cliche, but maybe something that sounds like it could have been a cliche.
And when you're writing script, because I think about certain lines that I hear comedians do, it's rare, but when they talk about the past, I remember a Gary Gulman routine where he said, I'm paraphrasing, but, like, when he says, you know, when I want to get mad at somebody and I want to say something to really tell them off, you know, I don't go up to them and say, like, go f*** yourself. I just go up to them and say, good day, sir. You know, and he takes something from the past in that routine and brings it to the future that everybody knows to get the laugh.
Yeah, or, like, if you tell someone to go suck 15 dicks.
the whole key is that it's just, it just has to be something. The idea is that, like, if you say a cliche, then everyone you're saying it to knows what you are saying before you're done saying it. And in joke writing in general, any kind of entertainment writing, you don't want the audience to know what the message you're saying is until you're done saying it. If they know what you're saying before you're done talking, that kills whatever in their brain will make them laugh. There's a certain kind of surprise that's supposed to come in with writing. That's why you put the funniest or most important word at the end of the sentence, because you don't want them to know what you're saying until you're done with it. If you keep talking after they know what you're saying, they will not laugh. And so, yeah, it's about trying to say things that they're not that they have, that it takes them a second to figure out, because it's a new way of saying something. And that's what makes it funny to people, you know, because saying, like, you know, boiling your hands. If you said wash your hands, by the time you say your, they know hands is coming next. It has to be a sentence that the audience cannot see coming.
Surprise and enlighten. But you know, Dave, I'm so glad we're talking about this, because one of the things I love most is the comedian who Penn and Teller's the joke and still kills. I'll give you an example. Mm-hmm. Bill Burr, Asians, the motherfucker before and the motherfucker after, and the different meaning of both. So he shows you exactly what's going to happen. Before he does it, you know exactly what's happening, and he still gets the laugh. And I think that's an incredible talent when somebody can do that as well, because it's more, I think it's more difficult, because you're showing the audience the knife on the table.
Yeah.
And the horror movie, and you're still getting the shock at the end.
You're still finding a way of surprising them in the execution.
Yeah.
In a way that, with a lot of joke writing, is you're telling them something that they never thought of before but instantly recognize is true, is sort of what that kind of joke, I think, is. Like, it's the idea that you're, and that's a very satisfying moment for an audience, when you're saying, like, oh, I never in my life put that together, but yes, of course that's true, that it makes sense to them. And that's a beautiful thing to find, and it's really satisfying to an audience member. I think that's maybe not as popular a kind of comedy anymore.
No.
Is sadly, but it is something that works.
I was just at the Cellar the other night, and I was watching Dave Attell close off a show. Of course, he loves to close off the show. And for anybody who's listening who doesn't know it already, there's just something about this man. I don't know what it is. I've known him my whole career.
I know what it is. All the other comics as good as him died.
I think that could be it. And so... And thank you. And so he's on, and I've known him since he hosted the open mic night at the Boston Comedy Club when he first started. And from then till now, there's just something that always, I just laugh so hard. It's not that I don't laugh at other people, but, and I remember things about what he did, and I know I'm not remembering them exactly the way he did them, but I'm still saying them over and over again in my head. I'm playing telephone in my head. And one thing that happened where I'm playing telephone last night, and just want to talk about the surprise and enlighten, but you sort of in the middle of, you know what's happening. He's doing a set and he's like, Ian, is that you? And it's Ian Finance. I hope I pronounce his name properly.
It is, yeah.
And, you know, Ian, for those of you who don't know Ian, very funny guy, has like tattoos all over his body, sometimes wears these weird shorts and white socks and sneakers, and he's got like a little pot belly, and he sometimes wears a hat, doesn't, and he has this smile that's like this, if the clown It were a human being, but obviously better looking, he'd have that kind of smile that's kind of fun but scary at the same time. And Dave, this is how I heard it.
He looks like if farm animals had pimps.
Yeah. So, but Dave says something to the effect of like, Ian, come up here. Good to see you. How was the day job at the, you know, I heard it like this. How was that day job going as a rodeo clown, you know, or something like that. And you just rodeo clown again, just the words put together. It's just, even though it just makes it so much funnier. And the line from one of his first albums, you know, my dad, you know, I don't like to travel, not because I don't like it, because my father beat me with a globe.
Yeah.
You know, just the word globe, you know, it's not a word that you hear that often. And I think I know you're, I consider you to be like this quiet savant, expert Harvard professor when it comes to jokes and comedy. And for me, like, I just study comedy and I always think to myself, and I don't want to beat this too much, but you can never go wrong as a comic by coming up with phrases that are original, unique, or that are very seldom used. You might bomb, but you're not going to get the respect of your peers for trying. Whereas if you do the easy thing, like you said before, you those examples, I don't think it's going to work. There was a comic I saw who shall remain nameless, great personality guy. Like, you're a guy who plants your feet and you sling the stories and the jokes. This is one of those guys who is all over the place, acting out the pieces, you know, the big personality guy, but still had great jokes. But then he did one joke in the middle where he said, hey, the girl, you know, blew me and I had to pull the sheets out of my ass with two hands. And I took him aside afterwards. I'm like, what are you doing? Like, why are you doing that in the middle? That's something that you heard in high school. You know, you have the personality, you have the premises. Why are you doing that?
That's an extreme lack of discipline.
And he just said, point well taken. And then there's the comedians now who, and it's, I think because Attell sets a great example, but he also sets a bad example, but he can because he's earned it. Pandering is a big problem in stand-up these days.
Yeah.
Because people, you know, they do a joke and they finish a joke, hey, oh, these guys are laughing, but these guys are on a real estate trip, and then they'll go to the other thing, and you know, oh, you didn't like that one, let's try this one, you know. And it's like, just do the fucking jokes. Do the jokes and stop doing that. Well, my video is talking to the crowd. They go wild and people love that. But the point is, no one's, you know, they're not going to respect Chappelle for saying, hey, what do you do? You're in accounting? Oh, what do you break into Jewish people's offices and screw up the books? You know, or are they going to remember the crack baby routine?
Well, I mean, interaction with the crowd, you know, crowd work is important to know how to do, especially when you're doing a live show, because there's a lot that, like, the audience likes feeling like it's real. They want to see a performance that has the element of this is real, this is happening, anything could happen, they're going to talk to us, it's going to make us more engaged. But it's also a crutch. Like, you shouldn't just be relying on that, because that's not what's going to make you a great comic. And like, you see comics who get too used to it, and it's like, yeah, it works, but it's like, but they don't really get anything out of the act, and you're not going to put that on TV. You know, we've seen people try to put crowd work in specials and it doesn't really work.
Yeah. Paula Poundstone, 25, 30 years ago, people don't know this about Paula, one of the greatest crowd work people of my generation. She would do 45 minutes of stand up. And then she would stop a lot of times and do the last 15 minutes of audience work only. Sometimes she would mix it all in. Unbelievable at it. Also, Jimmy Brogan, famous comedian who wrote for The Tonight Show, all crowd work. Clean, no, not dirty, fantastic, but it doesn't translate onto television. That's a really great point.
Yeah, it's for the people there. and that's it. But that's it, part of the job.
But now it people say it doesn't translate into television, but ironically, it translates onto the television in your phone.
To an extent. I mean, people put crowd work, on Instagram, and they'll show clips, and a lot of good comics do that. It's fine. It's not the kind of comedy that, it's not why you're doing comedy. For those moments, they're not burning material, so that's fine to put up, and you should use those. Okay, good. But I've never really seen a crowd interaction video that I found worth having watched.
I'll tell you, there's only one I've ever seen, and I'm not considering myself to be an expert on millions of clips of crowd work. And I'm embarrassed to say I don't remember the person, so the people watching will find it and they'll know who the person is and they'll recognize them. And I don't know if you've seen this or not. It's a guy, I think he was at the Comedy Cellar, and he's talking about relationships, his bad relationships and his family situations. And he says, nobody could have a story, worse than that or whatever. And the girl says, I do. And he says, tell me what it is. And no, I don't want to tell you. No, come on, tell me. And it was something to the effect of, my father abused my mother and she killed him. And it's like, right then and there, it's like, how the f*** is he going to get out of this? Because the crowd is just horrified. But he did. And he got out in a way that was unbelievably hilarious and funny and being lovable, but also being vulnerable. And that was one interaction that I thought was worthy of any comedian learning from, when you get in the situation where you talk to somebody and then they end up being special needs or they end up having Tourette's or something, and you have to figure out how to deal with a situation that's not just real life, but real life with people being uncomfortable.
Yeah, no, I mean, there are crowd work examples I look at as really masterful uses of that moment. I think one of the best examples of crowd work I've ever seen was a comic was getting heckled while he was playing his guitar and then waited for the guy to turn around and then broke his guitar over the guy's head and then said to the as the guy was turned around to take his jacket off and then said to the audience, you saw it, right? He was coming at me.
And the video, he's not coming at me.
No, he's not. That's what made it such a
holy shit, man. That clip is from 30 years ago.
It's old.
Oh man, no one's ever brought that up to me. I never forget that. Right before the video ends, he was coming at me. You saw it, right?
Yeah, guy was so stupid. He turned around and took his jacket off because the guy was getting on stage. He was threatening to get on stage, and you see the comic, just start to take the strap of the guitar off, getting ready to use it, and the guy's turning around, and it's people really need to understand that comics are the most dangerous people you can interact with. They've already thrown away all their connections to society. They already have no roots in the world. They are people with nothing to lose. You don't want to get into a fight with someone who has no one in the world to answer to.
You forgot one thing that I remember from the video before it ends. You saw it, right? It was coming right at me. And then there's this, right before it ends, you hear some guy say, that was uncalled for. Remember that?
I don't know. I don't know if I saw that far. But yeah, I mean, it was a little... some people would say it's an overreaction to yelling.
Now, what's the worst thing you've ever seen so far live in any room you ever worked in or anything where you were there? What's the most traumatic crowd work situation or thing that happened in a crowd that you've witnessed live?
Well, if this counts, I was doing an open mic probably around high school, in Jersey, and a comic was doing a fairly hacky bit about cloning back when cloning was a new issue. And another comic who looked exactly, who dressed and looked exactly like Bill Hicks, which is really funny, just not good, interrupted because he had done the same bit like the week before and is interrupting to be like, that's my bit. You saw, you were sitting there. I did that bit 2 weeks ago right here. And the guy on stage who everyone knows carries a knife is like getting mad and trying to like threaten. And he's got some friend of his who's like getting ready to fight. And the Bill Hicks guy gets on stage and they are literally ready to fight. And the funny thing is, it's like, it was one of those jokes where like, he probably did hear him say it, but it's also not the hardest joke to come up with on your own. I think the joke was literally, if I have sex with my own clone, am I gay? Or is that masturbation? If I kill my clone, is that suicide or murder? Like, it's not that good, guys. But then they started fighting, and the host of the night, Warren Holstein was the host of that open mic. Warren Holstein did by far the funniest thing I've ever seen him do on stage. No offense, but this is the funniest thing I've ever seen Warren Holstein do. Was he gets on stage and he gets real serious and he's yelling at the guys. He's like, don't you dare fucking fight in here. You will be banned from this open mic. And then turns to the audience. These guys have been planning this all week. Like, really sold the whole idea of that. You know, this was a bit. The audience knows it's not a bit, but he's doing a great bit of like getting them all, get off stage, don't you dare do it. You know, like, you will never do it. And then like finally gets him off stage. The next comic was this friend of mine, this middle-aged black woman, and she does her act. And the next comic is me, and I got on stage and I started doing her act word for word from the very beginning of her set.
Fantastic.
And that was fun.
Fantastic.
Yeah.
Fantastic.
It's like literally started because the first thing she says is like, as a divorced black woman. So it was like, it was such a perfect thing for me to start and to say, as a divorced black woman. That was really fun. Yeah, that was when I was doing when I was doing open mics in high school.
Hey everybody, I hope you're enjoying this episode as much as I am. If you made it this far and you haven't fallen asleep yet, and you must be the type of person who's serious about having a career in the comedy business. That's why I'm offering you my blueprint for success, a one-of-a-kind all-access pass into my knowledge and experience after over 40 years of working with the best of the best in this crazy entertainment industry. I'll tell you all the stories, all the philosophies, give you all the great special guests, and even give you one-on-one private consultations to help you expand, enhance, and skyrocket your comedy career. Just go to barrykatz.com and click on Blueprint for Success to learn more about my groundbreaking digital academy that I've created just for you. With it, we can take your career so far that one day, instead of listening to this podcast, you'll be interviewed on it. Now, you said something to me that kind of... Is it harder to write for yourself as a stand-up comedian or write jokes for another person, delivering them in a way, whether it's on a television show or not, that could easily, seamlessly work on stage? Does it bother you also after you write the joke for somebody that you think to yourself, why didn't I just save that one for myself?
I don't have that need for it to be me telling the joke. So I think that doesn't honestly apply to me. Like, I like seeing other people do well with my jokes. Like, and it's... And also, it's a wider audience. If I have a joke that like Triumph is going to do, there's just more people who are going to see it. So like, no, it doesn't bother me. I've done a lot of, I've written, stand-up is just not that important to me overall compared to like writing and stuff. So like, I don't have that thing where I'm like, I want to hold on to this for stand-up. There's a lot of times where I've written something. I mean, most of what I've written for Triumph could easily be a stand-up joke. Honestly,
no, that's what I'm saying.
And a lot of what I wrote for Pete is basically just stand up, you know, but for, you know, SNL.
But you don't have any feelings of remorse.
No, No, if I have a good joke in my act and I could have it on SNL instead, that seems like a good thing to do with it.
What about when Smigel or Pete, for some reason, undersell the joke and don't do well with it the way you know it could be sold? Because that happens like once out of every 10
sure,
times.
Yeah, that'll happen.
Do you have remorse that, I could have used that one? And
I mean, not really. Not honestly. Like, it's frustrating, but like, you're dealing with so much volume that I think one of the biggest things that comics have to learn when they get into the industry is to stop being precious, and that you can't act like everything you write is this important thing, you know, like a kid with a drawing. Like, you have to understand that this is disposable and this has to be a continuous stream of things, and none of these are ever going to be that important. Yeah, you can't think of an individual jokes that preciously.
You know, it's interesting, that's the next thing I wanted to talk to you about. You're right on point. Because I feel like a lot of artists don't understand, and you working with Judd, you know, I remember when I interviewed him, the thing he said that I think was so enlightening to the audience was when he was working with Shandling and he went on the road with him. You know, Shandling did the show, killed, but didn't do any of Judd's jokes. And he packed up his bag and was leaving, and Gary said, "Where are you going?" He said, "Well, you don't need me, Gary. You didn't do any of my jokes." He said, "Judd, I did almost every single one of your premises. That's the most important thing for me. I can write jokes all day long for these premises, but I can't get the great premise."
Yeah.
And so for what you said, what I wanted to talk about, you talked about how the jokes need to be like, hey, listen, these are like wet wipes. You know, just, you know, enjoy them, use them, and then don't be so attached to them. But also, you talked about the volume. But one of the things that I think comedians need to be more precious with is the premises. Because the premises, to me, like, are, if you can hit on a premise that's really, really extraordinarily unique, then, you know, you can write to that. You could do that premise and you could do a special and you could write 10 jokes with that premise. And believe it or not, you could go to another special and take that premise and write a whole new direction to it. And it still works. You, as a comic, yes, you're not supposed to ever do a joke ever again when it gets on television, but a premise can live on for a career.
Well, that rule also applied to back when people were actually watching television. But yeah, no, premises are hard. Especially, that's the hardest part of any writing project for me. Is the premise is the part that comes the least naturally for me.
That's odd you said that, because I'm totally wrong then when it comes to you. Because I'll tell you, because I perceive you to be a person who is in the position that you're in right now, because whether it was hard or not, you came up with a premise that aligned with other people's premises, and they said to themselves, this guy gets me. This guy understands the way my brain functions. This is a guy that I want next to me. And I want to say something else about you that I think the audience should know. It's very easy being the most valuable person in the room. It's very easy being the second most valuable person in the room. But to be the least valuable entity in terms of the public perception in the room, not your perception, not their perception, the perception of the world, and to thrive, that's one of the greatest gifts that any young artist can figure out and put the pieces of the puzzle to. And you figured out that equation to be able to be the guy who the public sees as the least valuable member of the team, but the people in the team don't agree with that. They believe you're equally value to them, and that's valuable to them, and that's why you're there, because you figured out how the premise worked in their mind and aligned it with them. And that's why I think you're so successful.
Well, thanks. I mean, I think that, like, there's a thing where you, where people ask a lot about how to make it, how to get into these jobs and how to make it in this industry. And the sad thing is that I have to really explain to people that, like, people don't really get anywhere from favors. Everyone expects that, you know, they have to get lucky. And it's like, yeah, most careers are not made because someone wanted to just be nice. They're made because they felt like they needed you. And they need, and like, you, your job is to be exploitable as a comedy writer or as a comic. Your job is to have something that someone more powerful than you is like, oh, I can benefit from this. And that's what you have to do. You have to just be good enough that, you know, you're providing something that's, that no one else in the room is.
I'll elaborate on that the way I visualize it through my lens. Exactly what Dave said. But then once you crack the door open, then you have to be invaluable and you have to add value. And if you don't add value after you crack in and get in, don't let the door hit you on the way out.
Yeah. Well, there are a lot of cautionary tales in the industry about people who managed to get their way in when they weren't ready. And that is worse than not making it, because when you didn't make it, you still have a chance. But I can think of a few examples of comics who were very good at getting themselves the attention and then completely fell apart once they got it. And it's a very sometimes the stories are very, very sad. Sometimes they're validating because it was a hack who didn't deserve it. And sometimes it's just people who they had certain abilities, but that they couldn't translate. I mean, there's so many, I don't want to like throw people under the bus, but like there's examples of like, we all know, you probably know who I'm talking about when I say like there was a very famous person who got very famous very quickly from a meme and doing something online that was interesting. But it's like, yeah, but you can't do that thing on a comedy special. So then they had to make a comedy special, and now they were doing the thing that they're not good at, and it showed. And it's like, that's a very dangerous thing, because a lot of people right now, the industry is all about like the last thing that you're going to get somewhere with is just being good at the actual job. You have to have made yourself big in stand-up or TikTok or something. And then we see what happens when someone might be really good at one of those things and then tries to make a movie out of it, and oh my god, you should have, who let this happen? When sometimes you see like how bad things can go when there's just a lack of oversight and there's a lack of discipline and maybe a little bit too much ego in the room, and people thinking that, well, you were great in this will translate. I mean, like, I'm not going to use specific names. I want to, but like, I remember being at SNL.
You're welcome to use whatever name.
I remember being at SNL and on Wednesdays, after you do the read through, you're waiting to see what sketches get picked. You have some time to kill. I remember the whole cast almost, we all watched to make fun of a recent movie at the time made by a YouTube. Okay, already anyone paying attention to this could definitely figure out who I'm talking about. But it was a YouTube comedy team that got to make their own movie. And it was watched, you know, and everyone was, you know, laughing at the wrong parts, because it just showed that, like, not everything translates. And you guys are probably the age that you could, that you're probably figuring out.
Dave is pointing to the people in the room, which is Mitch.
No, not Impractical Jokers. No, not at all. No. I would say they probably had a much better transition. But no, this was a sketch group that was very popular once. No, Key and Peele is good. What are you?
I'm just naming.
Okay, no. Key and Peele is amazing. No. That's the best example of translating to other art forms.
I know.
I mean, Jesus Christ, the both of them just. But it was just an example of. I mean, there's a. I can bring up somebody who your audience probably doesn't know about that I know Barry knows, who is one of the saddest, not funny examples of someone who managed to make themselves a star, and then everything fell apart. And his name was Chicken.
Yes, and so what What's fascinating, Dave, this is probably before you were born.
I was alive during Chicken's day.
So just to let you know, Chicken is a comedian named Michael Roof. He went to Montreal when the festival there was really, really huge, and you could do 5 minutes and you can get a development deal. And he, I believe it was Dave Becky at the time who was representing him after or before or whatever. But anyway, he does a set at the Comedy Works, which isn't even there anymore, a little club, and some people were invited down there to see him. I don't even know if he was part of the festival that year. And he got a $500,000 development deal.
Now, we should also, for the audience's sake, briefly describe what his act was like, that he got this $500,000 deal off of.
His act was 95% energy and 5% material.
Right.
A lovable, frenetic energy and a lot of yelling and screaming. And I'm uniquely qualified to talk about this because I had clients that I made a deal for, an overall deal, that were in that sketch show that he did for the WB. And I was very, very close to the people who were the showrunners. One of them was a former cast member of Saturday Night Live, Terry Sweeney. Mm-hmm. He was the showrunner of the show. And so I was with Michael a lot. But I will say this, one of the things that really blew me away about him, and it kind of showed what you talked about earlier on about comedians and how they have nothing to lose. He got cast in a movie called Black Hawk Down, and he had a phenomenal small part in that movie and was great, and nobody who watched that movie was laughing at his performance and saying that guy's shit. But you know, he completely collapsed in the business, in the sense because he couldn't sustain the audience in the comedy clubs or whatever, and he ended up taking his own life. But I will say this, I want to go the other way for a second, because I'm always blown away by the people who start when they're not ready, and then they calibrate. And they make the adjustment almost like they're almost about to get in an automobile accident, and they make the adjustment and they right themselves and then they take off. Chris Rock had 5 minutes at the comic strip. He just stood there, probably was 90 or 100 pounds at the time, had a thing on the stool, notes or whatever, and he would do the 5 minutes, as you know, the great 5 minutes of Bill Cosby is a racist and Fat Albert is a racist cartoon. And Eddie Murphy used to come in the comic strip all the time, saw him, put him on some kind of variety special or something he was doing, and then he became Eddie Murphy's protege. Then he started getting all these college gigs and these hour-long headlining gigs. He only had like 5 or 10 minutes. He would bring a notebook on, and he wouldn't do really well at these gigs.
He was a baby.
But he
was so new.
But he fought through it, and he didn't fold, and then he kept fighting through. And even when he did his first stand-up set on television, I believe, if I'm not mistaken, a fascinating story, Joan Rivers gives him the chance to do stand-up on her show. For those of you who don't remember, Joan Rivers was a guest host on The Tonight Show with Johnny Carson. She jumps ship and she takes a gig at Fox to be late night, doesn't tell Johnny. They never talk again. She's doing her show. That day, if I'm not mistaken, and I hope the audience looks this up, Chris Rock is booked on the show, his first stand-up, and her husband dies. Edgar?
Yeah.
And her show is canceled.
And he, the same reason, he took his own life, because he blamed himself for that move, for the effect on her career of going against Johnny.
Full circle.
Yeah.
So great you said that.
Yeah.
Dave, I love sitting down with you. Chris does his routine. He decides to still do it. She decides to still have him on. And he's doing his set, and they play him off in the middle of his last bit. Like, he's in the middle of his last bit and the band starts playing and he's like, and they go to commercial. He still recovers from that. And so And then he wrote his own movie, CB4.
I loved CB4.
Created his own movie. SNL people weren't laughing at that. They weren't laughing at the bad way. They were laughing about it the good way. And so the point is like, I'll give you two other examples. I hope I can give them. Eliza Schlesinger did Last Comic Standing. When she was found, when I was producing the show with Jay Moore and Peter Engel, like she was just, you know, she was a young comedian who was very confident, but she certainly wasn't headlining all over the country and doing big things. But she won the competition. She blew everyone out of the water. And when that happened, automatically it's like, we want you to headline all these places all across the country. And she, it felt like, seamlessly figured out a way to do the hour and convince the audience that even though I'm young, I'm an old soul and I am a seasoned professional and I will give you the best show you've ever seen. And she did. And that confidence and level of believing in herself and also being able to write to those premises that work so well to her audiences didn't derail her. She still went forward. And I love those stories of the people that are able to overcome those situations.
Yeah, yeah. And then there are stories like Darren Knight. And it just happens. It goes both ways.
Yes, yes, they do. And so you're thrown into a situation. I'm saying thrown into. I'm sorry, that's a bad phrase. You're not thrown into anything. You clawed into a situation where, technically speaking, there are many, many people in the world that were in their rooms smoking a cigarette, fidgeting, saying, how the f***? Why is he? What happened? How come? I was just doing an open mic with him in Jersey. Where he's repeating some woman's jokes. I mean, that, you know, what? How did he get there? I deserve that. I've been doing it much longer than him. What the f*** is going on?
Well, to be fair, no one did it longer than me. I don't know anyone on the goddamn planet who can say they struggled longer than I did. I was a failure longer than any sane person could ever hold out to make it in this industry. So in that respect, I'd say that's the one thing I can say to people is that when anyone who thinks that like maybe they deserved it, I'm like, at your let, when I was doing as long as you, I was nobody also. No offense. But that's true though. It took me a very long time. But even so, yeah, a lot of people, I can rattle off, definitely thought that it was just luck and that they could be there too if they just managed to find their way in. And I've known a lot of people like that who they put all their time into their marketing. They put all their effort into their ingratiation, and it doesn't matter. If you can't do the job, it doesn't matter whose ear you get into. And not that many people can do that job, can do the job of like writing alts at any point, writing joke. Like there's a discipline to joke writing.
Don't lose your place. Tell our audience what you mean writing alts.
Well, writing alts is like when you're working on a movie or TV show, like as a writer, especially if you're not in charge of the show, chances are the person who's in charge is going to have the final say as to what those scripts are. And that especially if you're a low writer, if you're a newer writer, the way that you're going to get into that movie or TV show is by pitching alternate lines for whatever's being shot that day. And so when I was in King of Staten Island or Bupkis or other jobs that I've had on movies that are still coming out where I, you know, was just hired as a hired guy to just pitch alts, your job is to simply beat whatever was already written and to replace whatever was already written and to just say, well, maybe when they're in the editing room, they'll be like, well, mine was actually better. Now, when you do that, a lot of times you're not getting credit. You're not getting your name on the movie, but you got something you put in it. And that's something that, you know, I really like. And I think a lot of it is about ego and about being not needing the recognition, not needing people to know, you know, and not caring that like there are a lot of people who are going to assume things about how much work you're actually doing, about who's doing what and about how much you earned, what you have. And then there are going to be people who work closer with you who know what the truth is. But I know there are people who think that they could easily have done exactly what I did and they couldn't. And there are people who could. But I can think exactly of who I've known who thought that they could do this. And all they ever did was work toward getting there and not being able to do it. And it's a discipline. It's a lot of discipline to be able to always be able to write jokes at any moment, like to not just be inspired, not just go through your day and be and think of something, but to be like, okay, right now, write 10 jokes. And the fact that the two people in the industry, that the biggest people I've worked for have been Judd Apatow and Robert Smigel in terms of like storied history and comedy. Those are people who are both very known in the industry for demanding a huge workload, for people who want you to really crank out a lot, more so than most people, but maybe less, but maybe not what, not more so than you should. So that's been something I benefit from and I like. And I also like the fact that like those are people who kind of have reputations for being, you know, for making you work really hard. But I didn't think that. I didn't feel that. It didn't feel like it was that hard to me, which is the thing that made me survive in those environments. I remember one time working on a Smigel show, and you know, it was a hard show. It had to do with topical news, and you know, it was a very, you know, it was you had to really write a lot very quickly because we're writing about the news, we're writing about current events, so you have to really crank out a lot really fast. And I remember one time we ended up being at work for a very long time, and it was more than 12 hours, which was unusual as writers. And I remember everyone there at the time was like, oh man, it's getting so late. You know, they all have families at home. And I'm just like, guys, we're getting paid twice as much after the 12th hour. Let's just hang out. Like, I'm the only one who's like, let's keep going. We're getting paid more right now. Why not do this? Like, for me, it was just like, oh, cool. I get to do what I like, and I'm getting paid more for right now. Because usually those jobs aren't hourly. This one was. Yeah. And I was like, fine with it. I'm like, hey, guys, you know, we're getting good work done.
As always, this has been Industry Standard with me, Barry Katz. And if you like the show, tell all your friends. And if you don't like the show, tell all your friends.
You get all the money, drive that fancy car. All the people love you, 'cause you're going far. Life is for the dreamers. They have all to gain. It's never quite over till it all feels the same. You pick your own poison, dig your own grave. Down in the valley, a fortune.
Thank you for listening to Industry Standard with Barry Katz. If you'd like more info on our schedule of new episodes or how to reach Barry through Twitter, Facebook, or email, go to BarryKatz.com. Before you leave, please take a moment to subscribe to our podcast, leave a comment, and rate it, even if you think it blows. Thank you for your support, and have a great day.
Hey, everybody. Let me remind you one more time about my new blueprint for success. It's a project I've spent months and months working on just to help you jumpstart your comedy career and beat the competition. Whether you want to do stand-up, sketch, improv, acting, writing, producing, directing, radio, social media influencing, or even if you want a career behind the scenes as a manager or agent, Blueprint for Success will give you all the tools you need to take your career to the highest levels. With exclusive interviews, my top 50 commercial-free episodes from Industry Standard, one-on-one coaching with me, and unprecedented access into my knowledge and experience from over 40 years in this crazy business. I guarantee you that with Blueprint for Success, you'll become the creator you've always dreamed of becoming. No one's asking me to do this. I want to do it because I want to help you become truly undeniable. So just go to BarryKatz.com, click on Blueprint for Success, and start your incredible journey today. I truly can't wait to work with you to help you change the trajectory of your comedy career forever.